Very good evening, everyone. And this is Dr. Apar. Every Tuesday, we are meeting with healthcare professionals, the doctors who have done something different than the usual. And we are here once again, talking to another, yet another person who has done exceptionally different than his peers. In fact, it is a couple. Dr. Ashish Sathav and Dr. Kavita Sathav. Dr. Ashish is a MBBS and MD in medicine, and Dr. Kavita Sathav is a ophthalmologist. She is a ophthalmology surgeon. Both of them are co-founders for an institute called Mahan, which works in a very remote area in Maharashtra, the central India, Amravati district. It's a place called Melghat. And they have been working for the health of the tribal people who are otherwise deprived of a lot of other facilities which are available to them. I wholeheartedly welcome Dr. Ashish along with us. Welcome.
Thank you.
Dr. Ashish Sathav.
Thank you, Apar and team.
And Dr. Kavita, unfortunately, is unable to join with us today because her mother is not keeping well. We wish her very well. But prior to our interaction with Dr. Ashish, I think we would like to understand their work, which is very beautifully shown in a YouTube video, which I'll be playing for all of us. So this 5 minutes, we will have a YouTube video on Dr. Ashish and the team's work, which will have a preamble for what we are going to witness today.
Mahan is an inspirational journey of a doctor couple, Kavita and Ashish Sathav, who embrace serving the poorest and most deprived tribal people of Melghat region and settle themselves in village Utavli of Melghat without even getting lured by a lucrative big city medical career. Melghat is situated 150 kilometers from Amravati district of Maharashtra in central India. Most of the population here belong to Korku tribe, who are small farmers or agricultural laborers living below the line of poverty. When the couple arrived here, there were no hospital facilities anywhere close by. The infant malnutrition was at its peak and was 10 times beyond the official government statistics. What started as humble beginning in the year 1998 has now blossomed into a large non-government organization which is effectively serving and saving life, which is reducing infant mortality and addressing malnutrition issues, which is building sustainable healthy communities, and which is helping tribal people raise their standard of nutrition and healthy living. Let us unfold the Mahan journey over its key accomplishments. The hospital, which began in a small hut, now has modern medical equipment, OPD, ICU, pediatric unit, and an eye hospital. Mahan, with the help of known doctors, conduct frequent plastic surgery camps, eye and cataract surgery camps. Mahan has identified and trained tribal women in 32 villages of Melghat who have had 5 to 10 years of schooling and being mothers themselves. Village health worker or Arogyadoot, as they are called, treat pregnant women and children under 5 years of age who are suffering from acute respiratory infections, diarrhea, malaria, malnutrition, neonatal sepsis or birth asphyxia. Mahan also produces ready-to-use therapeutic food and vitamin and mineral supplement, employing tribal women to produce and pack 9 varieties of whole and powdered therapeutic food. These are distributed to the Arogyadoots, who provide them to children in their village who suffer from severe acute malnutrition or who are severely underweight. In order to improve the quality of diet, Mahan has trained villagers to start their own kitchen garden on a small plot near their homes or on their farms. Basic vegetables such as ladyfinger, chilies, tomatoes, soya bean, mushroom, etc. are grown. This has directly helped in adding nutrition to the daily diet and saving of cost for farmers. Mahan has helped in developing over 7,500 nutrition gardens, growing nearly 80 tons of vegetables. Melghat experiences very heavy rainfall during monsoon and severe scarcity of water in summer. Mahan trusts with the help of Dilasa and Caring Friends Group developed DOE model, an innovative model wherein water does not dry up despite all other water bodies going dry. Mahan has gifted the DOE scheme to three villages who have vowed to give up social drinking and have channelized their energies in progressive pursuit. Under another innovative program, Umang, Mahan has appointed a Yuva Doot who helps villagers in seeking benefits from various government schemes. Dr. Sathav is closely associated with the government of Maharashtra and has played an important role in framing of 15 important state-level policies benefiting over 500,000 tribal people. Mahan has also developed framework of counselor program. Under the program, local resources are recruited at the public health centers. They listen and understand to the patient issues. They communicate in Korku and help patients in getting proper and timely medical help at public health centers. Mahan conducts several researches in its intervention area. In collaboration with University of Colorado, Mahan has taken charge of systematic data collection and evaluation of nasal swabs from a child who succumbs to pneumonia. This research would bring a significant change and set pitch for global health policy on RSV vaccination. Dr. Kavita and Ashish Sathav, along with dedicated staff strength of 200 strong people, are working tirelessly in revolutionizing the health scenario in the region. The team has won several awards and recognition for their outstanding work from national and international institutes. Scores of individuals, corporates, and medical professionals have come forward to support Mahan in improving health of tribals of Melghat. It is our duty to support and help Mahan, truly a cause worth supporting.
I think the video gives us a brief idea of the entire journey of what Dr. Ashish and his entire team, along with Dr. Kavita, has been doing. A very warm welcome once again to Dr. Ashish here.
And thank you, Apar.
Yeah, every week we meet with people who are able to inspire, the doctors who are able to inspire the next generation. And this whole initiative has been a part of Prayas Amravati, Kalya Health, and Own Your Growth, a team of young naturopathy physicians, going to be physicians. So we are collaborating on getting different people in front of the people. I welcome Dr. Ashish once again for this program. And I would like to start the program by asking him, why? I mean, I know that you have been a medical practitioner yourself, and you were also a professor in a medical college. So why leave that and go to a tribal remote place and start working with those people? Dr. Ashish.
Yeah, hello. Good evening, everybody. Actually, my grandfather, Mr. Vasantrao Umbatkar, he was a Sarvodaya worker. He has dedicated his whole life for the welfare of poorest of the poor, along with Mahatma Gandhiji, Jayaprakash Narayan, and Acharya Vinoba Bhave. And when I was young, at the age of, I think, 14 or 15 years old, I read a book written by Mahatma Gandhi, Experience with Truth. And he has mentioned that real India lies in villages, and youth should go to village to serve real India. And that really inspired me. When I was in 9th standard, I attended the Shram Sanskar Chhavani organized by Baba Amteji, and that has inspired me more for social work. After joining medical college, I started visiting various places like Melghat, Gadchiroli, and Dr. Abhay Bang, Dr. Prakash Amte, Dr. Avinash Sauji, etc. after visiting these people, I realized that there is lot of need of medical services in such tribal areas. And at that time in Melghat, there were no much more hospitals, just one or two primary health centers were there, and just two medical officers were present over an area of around 4,000 square kilometer with population of around 3 lakh. And a lot of children, youths and mothers are dying. Malnutrition was at its peak, and it all actually attracted me and it asked me to come there and stay in that area too. So since I decided to go and stay in Melghat, and since last 23 years I am here. This is my beginning.
23 years is a long, long time. I'm sure you must have had wonderful experiences during the whole time, and also a lot of challenges during the entire journey. Could you please share how it was when you started going to that remote area, and what were the challenges present when you were there?
Actually, when I entered there, we started with a small hut. You have seen in that documentary film just now, which is around 22 years before. It was very tough at that time. There was no electricity in our hospital in the beginning, no water source nearby. Like, we have to manage patients in the hut with the help of torch and candle like this. And once, I do remember, there was one critical patient of heart attack. He was brought to government hospital, and as there was no expert doctor in government hospital and no critical care unit nearby, they called me. When I went there, I saw a young man suffering from acute myocardial infarction with pulmonary edema, congestive cardiac failure, and he was on the verge of death. Initially, I thought if I will treat that patient, and he might die because there was no critical care unit with me also. There was just a single ECG machine, injection streptokinase, and 7 standard plasma assistant. When I was in medical college, there was a team of 5 to 6 doctors, assistant, nurses, well-equipped ICU and library. Here, nothing was there. And at that time, I was living in hut, driving bicycle for going to hospital. And many of the tribal, actually, they never believe that such a highly qualified doctor can come and stay in such an area. So if by mistake that patient die, because there was chance of 10% of death in acute myocardial infarction even after proper treatment, then probably people will kick me out of that area. And I thought a lot. I thought if I won't treat that patient, then probably, though after treatment there is chance of survival of 90%, and if I won't treat that patient there, he's going to die, chance was 100%, because another critical care unit was around 150 kilometers through mountains and forest and river, etc. And it was really very tough. So I started treatment at 12 in the midnight, and at around 5 in the morning, the patient got better. And throughout the night, I was just sitting beside his bed, measuring pulse, BP, as there was no monitor, taking ECG after every 15 to 20 minutes. And after that, patient survived, and the relatives and other citizens of Melghat, the tribals of Melghat, they realized that I am a good doctor, and then patients started coming. This was first big experience. Second, coming to challenges, when Kavita joined Melghat, Kavita is my wife, she is ophthalmic surgeon, and at that time, there was no concept of eye doctors. The tribal used to think that after the age of 40, blindness is a normal phenomenon because they never heard of eye surgeon. And they used to think that a lady doctor must conduct delivery only. So patients were very reluctant to come to her. She many times used to get depressed. Yes, because before that in medical college, she used to treat hundreds of patients daily. And here one or two patients are coming. Then she's decided to go and visit various villages. And then she visited around 350 villages in Melghat and 100 tribal villages of Madhya Pradesh. At that time, my son Athang, he was just 6 months old. She used to try Athang under some tree And Jopa, people must be aware of Jhula like this, and screen the patients, bring them back into our ambulance and feed them first and then operate them for cataract. The people of Melgaard, they were very reluctant for surgeries because of superstitions. They used to think that the doctor will remove the lens or eye completely and put some goat's eye or some other animal's eye. So it was very difficult to convince them. But after a few surgeries, we could convince the tribal about importance of cataract surgery, because now the patients who were bilaterally blind, even could not go for defecation or micturition without support, now can walk, do their routine work, help the families, and it's increased her rapport in the community. Once there was home delivery, at that time home delivery was 95%, as there was no gynecologist or obstetrician in the area. Kavita was called for that home delivery. Kavita refused, said, "I am not gynecologist or obstetrician, I'm just eye surgeon, and since many years I have not conducted any delivery." The parents went back, but next day they came again and they said, "Doctor, now please come, because the head is coming out." Then Kavita went with her cataract surgery instruments. She saw head is coming out. The mother was lying in pool of blood. There were a lot of tears in the genitalia. Anyhow, Kavita can deliver that baby, but he was suffering from birth asphyxia, that is, not able to breathe properly, not able to cry. And as it was home delivery, there were no equipment. She took her to the hospital, then did suction, and that baby started crying and came back. And then with the help of cataract surgery instruments, Kavita stitched that baby, mother. And after a few days, I saw a person coming to my home, Delhi, collecting something in a kettle, and going back. When I inquired, I came to know that the mother could not breastfeed the baby because of lactational failure. And at that time, Athang, my son, he was just 3 or 4 months old. And Kavita used to give half of her milk to Athang and half of her breast milk to that child for 15 days and could save his life. So it was very challenging because there is no milk bank in that area. And that was very big eye-opener for me also. And then we taught it to our village health workers, who are local trained tribal females trying to save the children in the villages. They also practice similarly for and served many children in that area. I think a few years before, coming to another challenge, as you know, Melgaard is known for malnutrition and child deaths. The infant mortality rate as per our baseline survey was around 90 per 1,000 live births. And on government record, it was just 31 per 1,000 live births. The prevalence of severe malnutrition was 9.6%. On government record, it was 1.2%. So there was severe underreporting. And we thought that unless the reality is not exposed, government is not going to plan for betterment of most of the tribal children. And hence, we exposed the situation through media, print and electronics media. At that time, there was no social media. And due to all these things, the government officers, the political leaders, they were exposed. It was proved that they are not working. And then they put fake cases against me and Kavita, like atrocity case, conspiracy of murder case, and molestation cases. It was a very tough time for us because the whole government system was involved in that racket. And there was constant threat of arrest for nearly 1 to 2 years. During that time, Kavita once arranged one ophthalmic camp, cataract surgery camp, where 33 patients, blind, poor tribal patients, old patients, were supposed to be operated. And I requested Kavita to postpone the camp because other than me, there was no physician or no anesthetist in that area. It is very difficult to conduct a surgical camp of 30 cases without such support. Kavita said very bravely, she said, "Kashish, don't worry. If I postpone the camp, many of the cataract patients, they are fully mature cataract. If I won't operate, they will go permanently blind. and it's very tough for her to admit that, not cooperate. And I requested that we should shift that patients to outside cities. She said they won't go to any city as they don't like because of superstitions and they can't afford to go outside. And then she decided to go ahead and the patients were operated and Honorable Court of Dharani and Amravati, they said that Dr. Sato has not done any mistake. No atrocity was done. No conspiracy of murder was done. And we were relieved from that case. So there are some interesting challenges in our life. But friends, these challenges, obstacles are not obstacles. These are real challenges to prove yourself. Like, it's like a river. When the river flows on plain road, it is not as beautiful. But when the river goes through mountains, flows through mountains, jump below it in the form of a fall, it looks more beautiful. So our life is like that only. Obstacles made us much more strengthful and much more healthy, and our life become more joyful.
So wonderfully put, Dr. Ashish. Really, there are goosebumps on my whole body right now listening to your experiences, and I'm sure all our viewers will reciprocate the same feelings. Sharing the milk of your own child with another child of a tribal takes a lot of heart to be in that situation, and the kind of challenges that you are narrating. Really, really amazing work. So we would like to know from you, what are the kind of health scenario in the area where you're working? For our viewers, the place where Dr. Ashish is working is about 150 kilometers from the district headquarters. And this is a tiger reserve in central India, in a district called Amravati, in a small place called as Dharani. And this whole area is the people who are living are the tribals who are there with Korku community. So what more can you tell us about this community and the practices, and what are the kind of health problems that these people have, Dr. Ashish?
Coming to health problem first, known for malnutrition. The prevalence of severe malnutrition is around 20%, which is very high as compared to rest of India. Even it is around 6 times as compared to African countries. You must have actually read in newspapers about the African countries like Ghana, etc., where the prevalence of severe malnutrition is just 3%. The infant mortality rate is, at that time, it was more than 90 per thousand live births. Still, it is more than 60 per thousand live births, which is against one of the highest in the country. Along with these deaths of children, the maternal mortality rate is more than 300 per lakh live children's live births. And the deaths of people in the economically productive age group, that is in the age of 16 to 60 years, it is more than 400 per lakh population, which is twice as compared to cities like Bangalore and other metro cities of India. So deaths are very common. The health scenario is not very good. The doctor population ratio is very poor, 1 as to 10,000. A mother had to walk around 19 kilometers to reach a primary health centers with MBBS doctors. And due to that, they prefer not to go to hospital and treat the children at home with traditional faith healers known as Bhumka, Parihar, or Bhagat. The other common illnesses like anemia is very common. 90% of the patients are pregnant mothers and children. They are suffering from anemia. For mothers, the disease like postpartum hemorrhage, antepartum hemorrhage, obstructed labor, puerperal sepsis is common. Diarrhea, malaria, pneumonia are the major killer of children. Newborn diseases like low birth weight babies, they contribute around 46% of total newborns. Premature babies, neonatal sepsis, birth asphyxia, these are the common illness. Surprisingly, hypertension is very common in the tribes. Tuberculosis is one of the major killer. The underlying causes is like poverty. 80% of the people in this area, they are still living below poverty line with family income of less than 5,000 per month, with family of 5 to 6 person in each family. So you can imagine how tough for them to run and to earn and to take care of their children and to feed them. Along with that, like most of them, they don't have employment for 6 months. They can do farming for just 5 to 6 months because during the summer season, the temperature is very high, 47 to 48 degree, and there are no sources of water during summer season. Being hilly terrain, though during rainy season, there are heavy rains up to 1500 millimeter. During cold season, it goes up to 2 degree, but the water bodies are dried during summer and they can't grow much more food. And as there is no employment, they have to migrate every year. Around 25 to 30% of the population migrate to cities for work. And when they come back during holy season, they bring various diseases, with infectious diseases like HIV and now corona, which is one of the major threats in this area also. Considering the lifestyle, they usually live in huts, small huts, which is without proper ventilation. They cook in their cooking room. There is no window. So the small children in that room, they inhale the same smoke. These people, especially male, they are heavy smokers. They are alcoholic. That further precipitated their illnesses like alcoholitis, jaundice, cirrhosis of liver, alcoholic encephalopathies, suicidal tendencies. A lot of suicides are very common in this area because of alcoholism. Smoke-induced oral malignancies are common. Cancer of breast is common. Uterine malignancies are common. And sexually transmitted diseases are common. The other challenges are like during summer season, the female has to work very hard to fetch water. They have to walk at least 2 kilometers, 2 to 3 kilometers to get potable water at home. And hence, they can't think of using toilets for defecation. More than 80% of the tribal, they practice open-air defecation, go to river for bathing, or to some hand pump somewhere in the village. So it's very tough time for most of them. More than 50% of the people, they don't have their own source of metered electricity. How we can imagine that their children will study in such a darkness during evening hours? These are the difficult challenges for these tribes. And for getting hospital facilities, as I told you, there are only few primary health centers. Specialty is very rare. Just from 2 years, there are some gynecologists and pediatrician. Before that, there was no expert doctor in this area other than we two people. And I like to mention few stories like that. There was one young female child, around 5 years old child, who was suffering from cerebral malaria. She was brought to our hospital in comatose condition with convulsions and decerebrate posture, which is considered to be terminal part of life. And I'm not a pediatrician, neither Kavita. We initially thought of referring that patient to Amravati, but we thought she won't be able to go for more than 10 to 15 kilometers because there is no nearby critical pediatric care unit. And hence, we decided to start the treatment. And after third day, that child came out of comatose condition and survived. So there is some background why we could dare to treat this child in that way. When we entered in that area, as there was no pediatrician, and Athang, my son, was small, many times he used to get serious attacks of bronchial asthma and pneumonia. And every time we cannot go to CT for his treatment, and we used to read textbooks of pediatrics, Nelson, and discuss with friends who are in cities, pediatricians in cities, and try to treat my child. And that increased my confidence that I can treat our children also. And it was very beneficial for us because I do remember one more story. One young female, around 30 years old, she was widow, tribal female. She brought her around 2 years young child who was suffering from severe malnutrition and bilateral pneumonia. He was treated by traditional faith healers called Bhumka Parihar Bhagat with the help of garlic a necklace of garlic. Then Dhamma. Dhamma means they burn the skin with red hot iron rod. If suppose the child has pain on chest, the chest wall will be burned with that red hot iron rod. And similarly, he was treated. He was being treated. I requested that mother to admit the child. She flatly refused. After multiple requests, I used my Brahmastra. I said, Maji, यदि आप बच्चे को भर्ती नहीं करेंगे तो बच्चा मर जाएगा. She very coolly responded, Doctor, बच्चे को डब्बा हो गया है. डब्बा means pneumonia. उसको सूजी लगा. सूजी means injection. Because these tribals are very crazy for injection because of some quacks in that area. Bengali doctor we call them. And I'll take the child to home. She said, if I'll admit that child, I have four children at home. There are goats and cows, etc. at home. And who will take care of them? And anyhow, she very coolly said, Doctor, he is going to die. I was very surprised, a mother, how she can say like that. And the mother took that child after injection to home. After third day, I got the message that the child died. Similarly, in two different villages, five children died of diarrhea. Friends, we are thinking to settle down on Mars and Moon. We are very proud that we Indians now can reach to Mars. But here in area like Meghat, the 20% of Indian population are situated inside where diarrhea is still one of the major killer. 10% of the children and adults are dying of very simple diseases like diarrhea. And when Kavita heard this story, she requested me for 2 nights that we'll go to some remote villages. Every day we'll go to some different village, treat the child and come back. But I realized that there are 300 plus villages in this area. If we'll go to some village, there will be some child will be ill in another village. And parents cannot think of admitting their severely malnourished children because of poverty. And if they'll admit that child, they will lose their daily wages. Hence, concept of barefoot doctor came in my mind. And I discussed with Dr. Abhay Bang, who is one of my mentor. Dr. Abhay Bang told that you must have read about him. He has done a pioneering work in community-based healthcare. And we similarly started similar randomized control trial called home-based child care program in 40 of the tribal villages of Meghat. We trained local tribal female who were married, having children, as village health worker. These village health worker were selected through community meetings with the participation of the community. We trained them for treatment of child illnesses. A very extensive training it was. Most of the tribal were just 4th or 5th standard. 2 of them, they were completely illiterate. And you won't believe, over a period of 5 years, this tribal village health worker could reduce the mortality, childhood mortality by around 64%. The prevalence of severe malnutrition was reduced by around 68%. And it was due to intense desire of this female to save their community. And it was really eye-opener for all of us in that situation.
Well, thank you, Dr. Ashish, for that insightful discussion on the kind of challenges that people have in terms of their health. And as you rightly narrated, it is not just the health problems, but in the background of that, there is poverty, there is illiteracy, there is lack of resources to reach out to the correct doctors. And it is so heartening to see that, you know, people like you and Dr. Kavita are there to help people who really need. Otherwise, we are just talking about, you know, taking things online and everything is so simple. But it is so different scenario when we are looking at the other people, fellow Indians who are suffering from these problems. Well, I'm sure that you required a big team of workers, dedicated volunteers along with you to achieve what you could achieve. You just narrated one part of it, saying that village health workers were there, Who were the other people, and how were you able to get those people to work with you? And what is your team now? What are the activities that you undertake?
Yeah. If you permit, Apar, I'd like to show one small PowerPoint presentation that will give some scientific background.
It would be wonderful. So, yeah we can just go through.
I'll share it.
Yes, you can share your screen.
Just small PPT for 5 to 10 minutes so that people will understand. Can you see my screen?
Yes, we are able to.
Yeah. So, as you know, I'll just put it on slideshow. Yeah. Is it clear now?
Yes, very much.
Yeah. So, our breed is reaching the unreachable. Our area is situated in the northeast part of Maharashtra in Amravati district, which is 150 kilometers from the district place Amravati. There are two tehsils called Dharani and Chikandara. This is our beautiful village called, surrounded by dense tiger reserve project, beautiful river behind our hospital, and this is our hospital. You can see this river. This river divides Meghat from Madhya Pradesh. And many of the times, Kavita, she used to go to screen around 100 tribal villages of Madhya Pradesh. There are no facilities in that area. And many of the times, she has to travel through the river. And I do remember for 4 to 5 times, she was stuck in the river in dark night also. In the beginning, when we started, it was a small hut. This was my waiting room at that time. Waiting come examination room under a mango tree. Kavita, she used to visit interior of the villages, arrange different eye camps in that area. And at that time, as I told, home delivery was very common. It was conducted by most of the trained or untrained traditional birth attendant. 95% of deliveries were home deliveries. We could screen more than 260,000 people from 450 villages in such door-to-door screening camps. And now we have 30-bedded, well-equipped hospital. You can see this hospital with intensive care unit with facilities like you can see ventilator here, monitors, and this patient, young tribal patient, was suffering for heart attack. Many of the non-tribal, they don't believe the tribal hypertension or heart attack can be problem of tribes. But you can see here, this old tribal man suffering from severe heart attack with pulmonary edema was put on ventilator. We have treated more than 110,000 patients in our hospitals, and we have treated more than 3,400 critical illnesses, could save most of the people in our intensive care unit. Kavita has conducted more than 3,000 eye surgeries in this setup, especially cataract surgeries. Here you can see, once upon a time, you can see one small baby in a bag. Once upon a time, a female, young female, 25 years old, young female was brought to our hospital. She was in comatose condition. She was in puerperal sepsis, that is, the infection spread through the genitalia throughout the body, reached up to the brain. I thought probably if the mother would have brought to our hospital 6 or 7 days before, I could have saved her. And I heard a small voice from this bag. I thought there is a parrot in the bag. When open, I saw a small child. So there was no concept of proper newborn or child care in that area. So it was very tough at that time, and we could not save that mother. Many of the children and youngsters were dying in that area. That hence we decided to train our village health worker for treatment of such illnesses, childhood illness in the village, as there was no pediatrician. You can see from this graph, as most of you are from medical background, the under 5 mortality rate in the beginning, it was a randomized controlled trial. The under 5 mortality rate was more than 140 per 1,000 live births, while After our intervention of 6 years, it came down to 50 per thousand live births. Similarly, the infant mortality rate was reduced from 106 to 32 per thousand live births, and neonatal mortality rate and perinatal mortality rate also was reduced significantly. Malnutrition is very common. Can you see the photograph of Lakshmi? Lakshmi was severely malnourished, on the verge of death. Parents admitted that child in government hospital, but after 15 days, there was no change in her condition. So the parents brought back to her at their home, and our village health worker Mirabai brought Lakshmi to our hospital. Our pediatrician Dr. Dani Madam saw her and advised hospitalization. Again, parents refused hospitalization because of farming season. They said, if we'll admit the child, we won't be able to get food for next 1 year. It's really very tough for the tribals. They took Lakshmi back to home, kept at home, put in front of God, and they said that if let now God take care of Lakshmi. Hello. Sorry, there was a call from hospital. So we requested the parents, the late Mirabai, who is our 7th standard pass village health worker, let Mirabai treat Lakshmi at home. Mirabai treated then Lakshmi with the help of local therapeutic food, which we prepared at home in our center with the help of local tribal female, with the help of local only available food material, grains. And Lakshmi was treated for 3 months with this food, with the help of injectable antibiotics for 7 days. The same Mirabai, who is just 7th standard pass, gave injections to Lakshmi. And you can see Lakshmi after 2 years. She improved, she became normal child, and now going to school. We started then, after success of saving life of Lakshmi, we decided to conduct another randomized controlled trial called Community-Based Management of Severe Malnutrition, where we treated more than 2,000 severely malnourished children with local therapeutic food, and we got the recovery rate as compared to WHO standards or international standard, while the death rate was very less in our study as compared to WHO or international standard. Now, due to these interventions, the prevalence of severe malnutrition is very less. You can say in our area, it is less than 3%, while in the rest of the tribal area of India, it is 10%. Even in other, if we consider whole India, it is around 8%. So it is very less as compared to rest of India now in our intervention area because of the dedication of this tribal female. Similarly, we found that, as I told, the death rate in youths was very high. You know, friends, when a person in the age group of 16 to 60 years die, it is very big shock to the family, to the community, and the nation. We are losing more than 600 such youths every year in this tribal area. If we extrapolate this data to all tribal areas of India, India is losing 2 lakh youths because of preventable illnesses like diarrhea, tuberculosis, hypertension, and cardiovascular illnesses. Hence, we decided to treat these youths through our village health worker in the village itself, and we could brought down the age-specific mortality rate in the age group of 16 to 60 years from more than 500 to less than 300 per lakh population in the randomized controlled trial. While in the control area, there was no change, and it was statistically highly significant reduction in mortality. And due to these are all the intervention, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, they wanted to conduct the research on pneumonia. RSV pneumonia is considered to be a major killer of children, and nobody was knowing what to be done, what vaccine has to be developed, as there was no community data. And after intensive search in the world, Gates Foundation selected 4 centers for this study, and we are the only Indian site for this study. and they selected because of our scientific approach and because of our success before this. And we became the first organization in world where we could collect nasopharyngeal swab. You now must be knowing nasopharyngeal swab collection for corona. And our team of village health workers doing this nasopharyngeal swab collection in the community itself last 3.5 years. They could collect the swabs from the dead children, from pneumonia children. And the data which has been generated now will be used by Gavi. You might be knowing Gavi is the biggest organization in the world for deciding global health vaccination policies. And now we could conduct MITS also. MITS also a very scientific study called Minimal Invasive Tissue Sampling, again funded by Gates Foundation, where we became the first organization in the world where we have collected, done this study in ambulance or in the community. Our another intervention is counselor program for strengthening of government hospitals. This is the first experiment in the world where government hospitals are being monitored by voluntary organizations. All 17 government hospitals in Meghat and Amravati are being monitored. The local trained tribal youths, both male and female, are working as counselors in these hospitals. They are monitoring the health services. They are trying to convince the tribal people to admit their severely malnourished children and hospital delivery. That has increased hospitalization of severely malnourished children, that has increased hospital delivery, and that has improved the hospital services by more than 50% and improved overall health scenario of Meghat. And these are all scientific studies were then published by UNICEF and Harvard University in their joint publication. Even Lancet Global Health in 2017 has mentioned that the success of this community-based task-shifting intervention in reducing malnutrition and mortality was due to robust training program, reliable peer support, referral network, and sustainable incentives. And friends, as you know, these problems are not problems of Meghat only. These are problems of 20% of the Indian population. And unless and until we change the policies, the situation is not going to change. Hence, we decided to do such research, present in various national and international conferences. Even we took help of public interest litigation in Mumbai High Court, which has changed around 15 state government policies. If time permit, I'll explain those things also, if organizers permit, which is very interesting. And it has changed 15 policies as well as more than 7 lakh tribal population of whole Maharashtra, and World Health Organization has recognized this effort by giving Public Health Champion Award. It was President of India has also given awards to these efforts. And I'm very much thankful for your kind attention. Now it is open for discussion.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ashish, taking us through the journey of the activities of Mahan. Something that was very interesting to me was that Mahan, although it is intended to help people with their health, it has meditation as the activity in M. It has activity in terms of the AIDS, and H comes as the third thing. How did you derive at that term Mahan?
Actually, as you people are from naturopathy background and yoga background, when I was in 7th or 8th standard, I read a book written by Swami Vivekananda. He has mentioned the effect of raw yoga. He has even mentioned in that book that how you can control involuntary movements like heartbeats. That was very surprising for me, because in medical science, we always read that there are voluntary things which, like, I am moving my hands. It's totally voluntary movement. But I can't, the heartbeats are going on and I can't control it. But when I started practicing yoga as per Swami Vivekananda's teaching, I realized that even I can control my heart rate by controlling my breath, my thoughts, etc. And I was patient of perineal rhinitis. I was typical type A personality. And after I'm practicing this meditation and yoga since last 30 years, and I found significant change in my personal life it actually reduced my rhinitis attack significantly. It changed me from type A personality to type B personality. Then it increased peace of my mind. It increased the confidence. It increased the physical as well as mental strength. I can fight with the government. Friends, social change is not possible without sangharsha. Just vidhayak kaam jo hota hai, that cannot bring complete change. Because there are a lot of things where you have to flow against the routine life or pattern of life. आपको संघर्ष करना पड़ता है और इस सारे संघर्ष के जर्नी में मेडिटेशन हेल्प मी अ लॉट. आई डू रिमेम्बर व्हेन आई वाज इन मुंबई हाई कोर्ट फाइटिंग अगेंस्ट गवर्नमेंट फॉर द बेनिफिट ऑफ ट्राइब्स. आई फाउंड दैट इट वाज रियली वेरी टफ. 5 or 6 सीनियर मोस्ट आईएएस ऑफिसर इंक्लूडिंग चीफ सेक्रेटरी सिटिंग इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू. यू आर वेरी स्मॉल पर्सन एंड विथ ट्रू डेटा इज विथ यू. गांधीयन बैकग्राउंड इज देयर विथ यू. And you are fighting, and it is meditation probably which made me very strong. Mahatma Gandhi also was very strong believer of this. Swami Vivekananda, you must have read about along with Swami Vivekananda, Acharya Vinoba Bhave. Acharya Vinoba Bhave is the disciple of Mahatma Gandhi, and he has strong faith in meditation. He has written one book called Gitai. Gitai, that is translation of Gita. He has mentioned the efficacy of karma. So we have named our area as Karmagram. And second, he has mentioned in his second shlok called Stita Pradnashi Lakshane, means stable minds, how to stabilize your mind. He has mentioned this very beautifully. I daily used to chant that Stita Pradnashi Lakshane, and I read Mahaguha Me Pravesh meditation book written by Vinoba Bhave. And hence I realized that this is the way to change the whole life of ourselves and people. Hence we decided that Mahan will work for meditation. And hence we put that M for meditation. In our logo also, you will say the sign of spirituality. I am strong believer of that. And now, friends, you know, tobacco and alcohol is one of the major killer of youths in today's world. And in modern science, there is no hukma saikam jisko bol sakte hai, a very good medicine for treatment of this addiction. And I have a very strong faith that only meditation or yoga can change the inner mindset of a person and make him free from alcohol. We tried it in 3 villages which are now totally free from social drinking, and we want to save the youths from this addiction, and hence we have decided to add a meditation in M in our organization. A for AIDS, because HIV is again common. H health we are practicing. Nutrition is again, major issue, malnutrition, and N stand for malnutrition, and A stand for addiction, as I told. So this is in short, birth of Mahan.
A lovely name, and Mahan is actually translated as greatness, and you are doing a great job in terms of helping people who really need it. Very quickly, Dr. Satav, we are now aware that there are a lot of health challenges and lot of otherwise also challenges with the people who are tribals. But I'm sure there must be a lot of things that these so-called civilized society have to learn from tribals. From your experiences, can you share the good part of being with those nice people, nice folk of India?
Yeah, the most important thing is self-satisfaction. As you know, the rest of the Indians, they are not satisfied. If suppose one person has one four-wheeler, if he'll see bigger four-wheeler with the neighbors, he will crave for that. If one female has one good sari, she will ask for another sari if some neighbor is wearing good sari. But these tribals are not very crazy for such things. They are satisfied whatever they have. They don't have much more utensils even in their house, not food to it. Even if they are satisfied whatever they have. So everybody must learn a sense of satisfaction from these tribes. That is most important thing. Second, male and female equalness. I won't believe. I like to share one story. 30 years before, when I went to that area, at that time, there was only one bus to reach to Melghat. And from that area, I went to a very interior village called Kopda Dhana, which is 50 kilometers from Dharne itself. And one has to wait literally 6 days to reach from Dharani, to reach that village through river, through truck. There was no bus at that time. And at that time, I saw a funeral process. In funeral process, you must have seen the dead body has to be carried on your shoulder. 4 people has to carry the dead body on the shoulder. And I saw 2 young female carrying that dead body on the shoulder and going to for the funeral process to that Smashan Bhumi. You won't believe, friends, at that time, before 23 or 25 or 30 years, in even cities, the female were not allowed to go for such funeral process. And here, so you can imagine how developed this community was at that time. Even if I have not seen a single case of female feticide, there is not a single dowry date in this area. And you believe if female wants a partner, life partner, he can choose her own life partner. She need not have to be dependent on parents. The parents will not prevent her from choosing the life partner. She need not have to give the dowry. There is reverse dowry. The male has to give dowry to the female during marriage. If the male cannot give dowry, the husband cannot give dowry, then he has to work for a year in the house of female or in law's place. It is called lamjana. Unko lamjana rehna padta hai. So in that way, this community is really very, I can say, developed as compared to male dominant society of rest of India. Even, and that has been reflected in their health condition also. When we analyze the prevalence of severe malnutrition or mortality, we found that the mortality rate and malnutrition is equal amongst male and female. So in that way, this is another thing is the environment. It is very healthy environment. There is a lot of pure oxygen. You can say 100% pure oxygen in this area. And it's very, very healthy. And most probably my grandfather, he used to say that these tribals are very happy, always laughing. And the laugh is not artificial laugh as seen in cities. It is very natural laugh, natural smile because of poor oxygen. And I think less need. Mahatma Gandhi used to say that the earth don't have resources to fulfill your greed, but the earth definitely has resources to fulfill the needs of all Indians. And these tribals, they have really very less needs. We can definitely learn this thing from these tribals. It's a very hardworking community. They are not shy of doing any sorts of works.
That is so amazing. And I think life lessons for all of us to learn. I think I would come to a last question from my end. That would be if somebody would like to associate with the work that you and Mahan has been doing, maybe a healthcare worker, maybe an individual who is not in healthcare, if they want to associate with your work, how could they do that?
There can be 2 ways. Like you people are from meditation yoga background, and I want to conduct very big study on yoga and the addiction, a randomized controlled trial to prove the efficacy of meditation. Someone if can come and stay here for 3 to 4 years and start a good meditation center, conduct research with us and show a pathway, new pathway to world, probably that will be very useful. Second, you can come as a volunteers also, if not full-timer, part-time or some training workshops, etc. Or during camps, like we organize, many times we organize camps in such tribal areas. So you can come and serve as a volunteers. Or even if you cannot come here, wherever you are working, I'll request you people to do your work with full honesty. Think of the poor people. Think of the most downtrodden part of the Indian community, the tribes, the rural Indians, or the poor people in the city. If you cannot do free services for them, do some concessions to the poor tribal. But I will like to give some suggestions. If you want to do some good work in your life, it should be from your heart. I have seen there are a lot of youths who really want to do very good work for the Mother India. But at the time, there are few youths who probably have some confusion in life. So friends, be very clear, be very transparent. Whatever you think from mind, try to express outside. Don't think in different way and don't express another thing out of your mind. You require intense desire for good work, compassion, then you need some devotion to do any work. There should be great aim in your life. One should do hard work. There should be perseverance to achieve your goal, and don't stop till you achieve your goal. And you can spread awareness of our work. If you want to really help us, wherever you are in any part of world, any part of India, you can spread awareness of our work so that people can come forward to support our activities.
That's so amazing. A very nice message by Dr. Ashish. And his work has been awarded by the World Health Organization. His team has been awarded the Public Health Champion by World Health Organization. The Apollo Hospitals have awarded them as Healers of India. Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation have awarded them with the kind of work that they are doing. Their work has been published in Lancet, which is one of the most prestigious journals, medical journals in the world. So it's so nice to know your journey, know your work. And I think there are a few questions that are coming from the audience who would like to know a little more from you. So there is a participant called Anandi who is asking a question that she has been trying to work with the tribal people in Kerala. And Anandi wants to know more, how can she develop bonding with the tribals and how to handle them? Because there is obviously a difference in communication. You probably need to learn to deal with them in a little different way. So what will be your suggestion to her?
It's a very good thing that Anandi is interested to work with tribal. All the best for her work. Actually, if you really want to work with tribal, the most important thing is open heart and open mind. Just go sit with them, talk to them, try to understand. Language will not be a barrier. Try to understand their problem, mix with them very easily. These tribal people are really very good. They are very, you can mix with them very easily. And if you really try to understand their problem slowly and slowly, they will open it up. But you, as I told, perseverance is very important. You have to put a lot of efforts to reach them and to stay with them. And for language barrier, you can take help of some volunteer who is from the same community. Especially, you can help of female volunteer who has intense desire to serve that society. Then you can reach. And don't try to show that you are someone different from this tribal community. You have gone there to teach them, to change their life. Try to understand them, show empathy, and don't try to make them bigger. Try to understand their strength, try to understand weakness, mold yourself. As I told, when I went to this area 23 years before, I thought I'll run a hospital and teach the tribal about good practices, good medicine. But later on, I realized that just sitting in hospital is not going to change. So I went to the community, myself and Kavita both, mix with them, talk with them, arrange meetings with them, understand their problems, and try to solve their problems. Again, if you want to increase the participation of the community, you have to and they will definitely develop faith on you. If you persistently, don't get depressed at all, because it's easy to convince a non-tribal because they are literate, but it's very tough to convince the illiterate tribal, because your friends, you know, these tribals have been exploited by non-tribals in any part of the world, even in India, USA, and Australia. And say they are very reluctant to mix very easily with non-tribals. They always see with suspicious this non-tribals that somebody has come to just exploit me either monetarily, sexually, or some other by another way. So once you develop a good bond, good rapport with the community, they will definitely listen to you. Try to provide some, like one of the ways to bring some government schemes for them, like in tribal area. This tribe needs a caste certificate, which is a very small issue, but it is very important from this for this tribal people. And in the routine government system, they have to pay 2,000 to 3,000 rupees to get this caste certificate, which is ideally should be given free of cost. because they can't fight with this government worker. But if you can show that, if he'll go and help these people for getting such ration card, which is very important for getting ration from the PDS shop or from the caste certificate, from as you are qualified, you can go talk with the government officers, request them to give this ration card or jati ka dakhla free of cost to the tribals. Slowly and slowly, tribal will start believing in you that you have come to really help them, and then the bond will increase. Don't try to deceive any tribal by any means, and then I'm very confident that they will develop faith in you.
That's a very nicely put, Dr. Ashish. Be part of them, be with them to help them. And that is the simplest way that we can understand. Another question from one of the participants, Janvi Mishra, relates to another area of work that you are doing, addiction. So people who are addicted to drugs or alcohol or smoking, they usually do not seek consultation with a doctor or seek to get out of these habits. So how do you solve this particular issue?
Actually, what we did, we did holistic methods. We applied holistic methods to the addiction activities. We started with the addiction camps. Friends, though alcoholics are alcoholics or smokers are smokers, though they are addicts, most of them, they want to get rid of this addiction. They have intense desire, but they cannot do it. So try to understand who are such people who wants to get rid of it. Then try to contact family members of such persons. Try to get them in your camps. If you are arranging camps, either in the village or in your hospital, bring such patients to your hospital. Treat them with, for first 6 to 7 days, you can give some medications like drugs like Librium or paracetamol to prevent because withdrawal symptoms in such cases. Do intensive counseling, train them from the beginning for de-addiction, for yoga and meditation. This meditation has very good effect. It has proven scientifically that you can do, train them for meditation and do it as a group meditation sessions rather than individual sessions, because there is natural human tendency to learn from others. So by doing social meditation, they can learn good things, and it will increase the confidence of the person that he can remain without alcohol and smoke for a few days per month. And especially when you will change the whole community, a village, that will bring change in the mind of that person. The environment will change. Another thing what we did is arranging the community meetings. As in especially tribal and rural areas, there is very good thing of community bonding. The whole villagers, they celebrate festivals as one family. And if they realize that alcohol is not good, tobacco is not good, and if you can convince the important people in the villages, like in our tribal areas, it is called Pancha Committee or Gram Sabha, local Gram Sabha, a committee of local elderly tribal key persons in the village. If we take these people in confidence, explain them importance of addiction, and through them, if we arrange such meetings with the villagers, explain them the side effects of addiction, they do realize it. Then with the help of whole community, you can stop even production of alcohol. What we did in 2 villages, the whole villages have come forward after realizing its importance. They stop production of alcohol in 2 of these villages. And in 3 villages, they stop complete social drinking of alcohol. During Holi, the tribes of Belghat, they celebrate Holi for 5 days by drinking alcohol, dancing. But now since last 8 years, we did this only for 2 or 3 years, but they realize its importance. Once they realize its importance, they do it by their own. Now since last 8 years, they are not doing any social drinking. Alcoholism has reduced significantly in these 3 villages. So this is one of the methodology. Second, because some of the people, they produce alcohol or liquor at home and they sell it. So they are dependent on, it's their business also. So you have to give them another business. Like if you're in cities, you can teach them some other work. Like in our area, we teach them farming because they do have 1 to 2 acres of farm. If we did kitchen garden nutrition for them, so they get some employment. We give them some work, another work also. That is one of the way. Second, engage them in some sports. Like usually addiction takes place when the mind is empty. they don't have any work to do, especially like during evening hours when the people are tired, when they have nothing to do in rural areas because there is darkness everywhere. At that time, people usually smoke, people usually chew tobacco, people usually drink. So use this empty hours, empty minds of these people, engage them in sports. Like in our area, they like handball, they like kabaddi. We engage them in that area so that they will get rid of addiction. Do bhajans. But this tribal or rural Indians, they have a lot of interest in bhajans. So we arrange bhajan sandhyas for them. And slowly, you can make them free from such addictions.
That's really, I think, a holistic way of looking at addiction and the addiction control as well, trying to understand the mindset of the individuals and working on them concurrently. This was a wonderful session, and we also have feedback from a lot of participants, both on YouTube as well as Zoom. At both places, they have liked the interaction that we have had with Dr. Ashish. We wish a wonderful journey ahead to Dr. Ashish, Dr. Kavita, and the entire team of Mahan. Thank you so much for accepting to come down and be with our friends here, our viewers here, on the program that we have on every Tuesday, Doctors with a Different. Thank you, this different doctor, Dr. Ashish Satav. And we look forward to many more sessions like this. Any parting thought, Dr. Ashish?
Yeah. One thing I have to say, this all journey is possible because of the supporters of Mahan. Without their active support, we would not have reached to this destination. So I want to thanks to you people, to our supporters like Caring Friends Mumbai, Ramesh Ankal Kacholia ji, Nimesh Bhai, Prakash Apte ji, then Stitching Jeron, Arpan Foundation, our mentors like, as I told, Abhay Bang, Prakash Amte, and Avinash Sauji, who is father of Apar. Then our family friends like Payaskar, Varangaokar, Kashikar families, and other supporters, other surgeons like Dr. Dilip Khan, Dr. Kulkarni, and my family members, my brother's parents, and the whole tribals who supported us so nicely during the last 23 years. And thank you to Apar and whole your Kalna Health for arranging this very good seminar, and all of you for your kind attention. You are all invited to Meghat after COVID era. Thanks a lot.
It would be lovely. I have been to Dr. Ashish place, and I would highly recommend everybody to visit. And it would be very, very nice to be there with them at Karmagram and witness their work, because what we have seen on virtual media is hardly any percentage of what actually you can visualize when you are there with Dr. Ashish himself. Thank you very much, Dr. Satav, for being with us. And for my viewers, thank you very much for joining us for this wonderful journey of Dr. Ashish, Dr. Kavita, and Mahan. If you like this video, please subscribe to our channel, and please share it with people who are wanting to be inspired to do something different in their lives. We will see you again next Tuesday with Doctors with Difference. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful evening.
Namaste.